Are you ready? Let's see. Okay. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he hath redeemed from the hand of the enemy. Sounds pretty good. Okay.
I can go to the song one more time.
Thank you.
Well, good evening. Welcome again to our Wednesday night evening Bible study and prayer time. I hope we have a full house with us there in your house. And we're going to have a great time as we worship the Lord today. And so let's go ahead and we're going to start off right in Psalm. And we're going to sing Higher Ground. So I want to hear you singing out there at home. Hell, I want to see you tapping your toes. Your Juanita tells me you tap your toes every time we sing. So I'm counting on seeing that someday from a phone picture. I'm pressing on the upward way. I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I'm onward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand. My faith on heaven's stable land. Oh, higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. My heart has no desire to stay where doubts arise and fears dismay. Though some may dwell where these abound, my prayer, my aim is higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand. My faith on heaven's stable land. Oh, higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to live above the world. Though Satan's darts at me are hurled. For faith has caught the joyful sound. The song of saints on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand. My faith on heaven's stable land. A higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to scale the utmost height and catch a gleam of glory bright. But still I'll pray till heaven I've found. Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand. My faith on heaven's stable land. A higher plane than I have found. On higher ground. All right, let's go ahead and open up our service in prayer tonight. Father in heaven, we bow before your awesome presence. And indeed, we rejoice along with the songwriter and the words that he penned, Lord, that we're off to higher ground. That, Lord, we're looking for a place, Lord, that is far above every world quarantine that's ever been put in place. Lord, we look forward to that day, and we rejoice in the truth, Lord, of knowing Jesus Christ as our Savior and having the gift of eternal life. Now, Lord Jesus, will you meet with us here in this place as well as in every living room and every home tonight where folks are joining us to be encouraged by the Word of God. Lord, I pray that you would do just that tonight. Encourage them, strengthen them, uplift them, Lord. Help them to see, Lord, a vision clearly of the higher ground that we stand on. Even in this difficult time, Father, we can exercise our faith in Jesus Christ and find hope and comfort for every situation that we're in. I bless the study and the reading of your word tonight, Lord, that it might bring honor and glory to the name of Jesus Christ. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, let's go on. We'll get to our last song tonight. My Jesus, I love thee. They'll have a few announcements and we'll read one of our missionary prayer letters. My Jesus, I love thee. My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior art thou. If ever I love thee, my my Jesus, 'tis now I love thee because thou hast first loved me and purchased my pardon on Calvary's tree. I love thee for wearing the thorns on thy brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I'll love thee in life, I will love thee in death, and praise thee as long as thou lendest me breath, and say when the death do lies cold on my brow, if ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. In mansions of glory and endless delight, I'll sing with the glittering crown on my brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. Amen. I sure do love those good old songs of the faith. Let me, before I get to our missionary letter, just let me get to some pertinent announcements that's going to take place tomorrow. I have been watching many of the different Zoom conferences, many of the different YouTube conferences by lawyers, politicians, pastors, especially Pastor Chapel, and been listening to that on YouTube. And so we're going to be meeting with our Sheriff Benoist tomorrow morning at about 11 o'clock. And to be able to sit down and talk to him and share our concerns that we went past what I believe is obeying the biblical mandate to obey the authorities that be. And it comes down to a place in Hebrews 10:25 where we're under the command of heaven itself not to forsake the gathering or the assembling of ourselves together. And so we're going to take that time under counsel from Pastor Chapel, from lawmakers, from lawyers, and just sit down with him and explain to him our view and the necessity of the local church. And it was with Peter and John when they were locked into prison and they were commanded not to teach in the name of Jesus Christ. And they told them that, even after they're beat and stuff like that, that we ought to obey God rather than man. And so I was online with about 800 other pastors this week, and they're all about in agreement. We're not setting an exact date to start up, but I know a lot of the churches are hoping that it can be the last Sunday in May. And so we're going to be talking with our sheriff, trying to give honor to whom honor is due, and to be able to listen to his advice. And if we need to go any further, we'll try to get a hold of our county supervisor for the in-town area and talk to him also. And so the way we'll let you know about what is taking place and what is happening, make sure you keep up with the First Baptist Church Facebook page. And so as I get done with these meetings and find more information, we'll present videos over Facebook that'll let us know what is taking place and when we'll be able to meet back together. And so we'll be having a deacons meeting tonight after church and going over with them some of the things that we have to set in place when we do assemble again. A church is, many pastors are saying, Pastor Chapel, is a church as we know it may never be the same like it used to be. But God is greater than the fears of man. I know that God works in these difficult times, that there's always opportunities that we can find amidst all the obstacles. And so I would encourage you, stay informed on our Facebook page. Listen to the messages. Boy, the upload speed now has went from 0.8 kilobytes or whatever the measurement is to sometimes up to 20 or 15 to 20. And so the speed of that has just been super now. And we're thankful for all the work that's went into that. Now we're also going to be looking in to putting a special Verizon box up in the bell tower. Well, there's no bell there, but I don't know what that tower's for. And that'll give us a direct line of sight right with the Verizon towers up on Mount Bullion. And that will even increase the speed even further. But we will have to invest some money from the church to be able to do that. And it's very pertinent that we do that because church is going to be online probably forever from now on. And so I appreciate Matt and James, as I said often, that have invested their time and their talents and also their treasures in bringing us the quality that we have now. And so we'll be bringing that up at a later time. But we're really looking forward to the time that we can reopen the church. And so we'll let you know more about that tomorrow after the meeting with Sheriff Ben Weiss. And so I appreciate him opening up his office to give us that time in his ear to explain what our heart is. All right, let me read a prayer letter from the Keo family. Again, our missionaries in Cambodia. The letter's dated April 2020. Dear pastor and church family, Psalm 107, verse 1 and 2. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he hath redeemed from the hand of the enemy. Well, we are all shocked throughout the world by the lockdown of COVID-19. Almost everything here has closed, and we are told to stay home until further notice. Around this time in April, people celebrate the Cambodian New Year, but all the festivities and the partying have ceased because of the quarantine. All the roads leading out of Phnom Penh have been closed for 1 week. Now we have heard rumors that no one in the whole country has died of this virus. However, there were many infected with the COVID-19 who have been healed, except for one who is in the process of recovering. I have called and visited our people at their homes, reminding them to continue their personal Bible reading, along with their daily light devotionals. They have expressed that they greatly miss the services each Sunday. It is a blessing to hear that our people are still witnessing to their neighbors in spite of this quarantine. As you know, every Friday, my wife holds a Bible study for ladies, and many are still faithfully attending it. I would like to thank you for your consistency in your prayers and financial support, even during this time. And they have three prayer lists. Number one, wisdom for the ministry. Secondly, his wife's health. She has TMJ and glaucoma. And then thirdly, for the homeschooling of their children. And so that's even affecting everything, even in Cambodia. And it's really affected the relationship of the missionaries that are American missionaries there, because the virus got its foothold in Cambodia. And not from Cambodians, but from foreigners that had come and brought the virus into Cambodia with them. So I know even talking with Randy, it's caused some hesitation for people in the new area where he's moved, where they're a little bit fearful to get too close to you because their mindset is that COVID-19 is a foreigner's disease. And so that has affected the way missionaries are able to visit. As you've heard, they've shut down the roads in and out of the capital. So they've shut down the new year coming up, and that is big, big, big holidays that they're shutting down, just like the Chinese New Year that took place a few months ago also. And so be in prayer for our missionaries as this impacts them. Many of them had planned to come home, and now they can't find a flight to come home. Randy is planning to come home in August for 6 months and then go back and start his first church ministry. And so he is scheduled to be with us again in our missions conference along with Joe Merlo. And we'll just pray and hope that things will come back to some type of normalcy so we can continue planning. So right now it's very difficult to be able to plan on what we should do as far as upcoming events. So anyway, keep our missionaries in your prayers. And I appreciate all of you that have been so faithful mailing in your tithe check. What a blessing that is. And seeing people walk in, even during the services, seeing people walk in and put their tithe in and walk back out in their missions. And I appreciate that so much. And don't forget, this Sunday is normally the Sunday that we take up a love offering for Pastor Ron. And I'm mentioning that. He doesn't mention that. He would never even say anything about that. But we do want to remember him and how he is dependent upon the love offerings that we give him. So as the Lord leads you, participate in that also. Okay, well, let's go ahead and get right into our Bible study tonight. We'll be looking at Moses in Exodus chapter number 14 and verses 10 through 18. So if you go ahead and take your Bibles, Exodus chapter 10, verses 14 or verses 10 through 18, Exodus 14, verses 10 through verse number 18. And what we're looking at tonight is building a resume of faith. Building a resume of faith. Exodus chapter 14, verse number 10 through verse number 18. And when Pharaoh drew nigh, this is the children of Israel have left Egypt. They're going to be going across the Red Sea. And so that's where we're at in chapter 14. And when Pharaoh drew nigh, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them. And they were sore afraid, and the children of Israel cried out unto the Lord. And they said unto Moses, because there is no graves in Egypt, thou hast taken us away to die in the wilderness. Wherefore hast thou dealt thus with us, to carry us forth out of Egypt? Is not this the word that we did tell thee in Egypt, saying, let us alone, that we may serve the Egyptians. For it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness. And Moses said unto the people, fear ye not, stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show to you today. For the Egyptians whom ye have seen today, ye shall see them again no more forever. The Lord shall fight for you, and ye shall hold your peace. And the Lord said unto Moses, wherefore criest thou unto me? Speak unto the children of Israel that they go forward. But lift thou up thy rod and stretch out thine hand over the sea and divide it. And the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea. And I, behold, I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians, and they shall follow them. And I will get me honor upon Pharaoh and upon all his host, upon his chariots and upon his horsemen. And the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord when I have gotten me honor upon Pharaoh, upon his chariots, and upon his horsemen. So again, we're talking tonight on the subject of building a resume of faith. And over the last several weeks, we have dealt with Moses when he was still in the land of the Midianites, when he still was there at Mount Horeb or Mount Sinai, when God appeared to him in the burning bush. And what Moses didn't realize is that at that particular time when God reveals himself, that's when God begins to write the resume of Moses. And he takes Moses through all the different steps of building faith in Moses' life, building trust and confidence, seeing a bush that's on fire that's not consumed, and then listening to all Moses' excuses on why he wasn't the man, and then the joy of seeing Aaron, his brother, leaving Egypt and meeting him there at Mount Sinai, and the encouragement he got from his brother, and then going back to Pharaoh, and finally appearing before Pharaoh. But what God was doing for Moses for 40 years in the wilderness, he was erasing his previous resume. He was blotting out everything that he did know from 40 years before of living in Egypt. That resume was corrupted. That resume was all about what strength and man and the power of man and what man can do. And God had to strip that resume away and bring Moses down to a place where he has no confidence, no strength, no ability, and he has no faith in himself to be able to fulfill the words and the will of God. So now God is going to begin to build a resume in Moses' life. And this resume is going to start when he is 80 years old. And all of us as adults and maybe younger or older teenagers, all of us know how important a good resume is. And so in a resume, as we start off, we list all of our educational accomplishments. We talk about what university or college we went through to. We talk about any honors that we received in graduation. We would list in the high school all the different clubs that we belonged to. We would write everything that deals with education that would give an employer insight into our character. And so resumes are very, very important. And not only do they list your education and your accomplishments, the awards through education, your major, what your grade average was, and then it lists all your past job accomplishments. All the way back at 15 years old when I started working at McDonald's, and so that first resume would start with the job opportunities of doing nothing but wiping tables. At 15 years of age, you weren't allowed to even go behind the counter at McDonald's. You only could stay out in the lunch area and wipe the tables and throw the trash away. And so then that job accomplishment would go there, and I would put on there what I did and how things improved and how I benefited the company. And then each job from that point of our youngest experience all the way up until the present time, we list our accomplishments that we accomplished in each of our job areas. We would list how we successfully dealt with the adversities of the job, and how that when we took the job, it was not in a very good position, it was not in a good shape, but after we left, now it was a productive place, and the company was prospering because of our abilities to work through adversities and learn how to get victories over difficult challenges. And so we want to put that in that resume. We want to put in that resume past job performance reviews that look good upon our resume, that talk about our strength and our character and how we performed on that job. And so we put all of our past experiences that will impact our future accomplishments. And that's the key. That's what I wanted to understand about the idea of resume. It's all of your past experiences. And those past experiences are going to impact your future accomplishments. So Moses had to start all over again when he was 80 years. For 40 years, Moses was having his resume wiped clean by God Almighty. And at the age of 80 years old, now God is going to send Moses through some adversities. God is going to challenge Moses. And Moses is going to start out not believing God. But slowly as God continues to work in the life of Moses, and we see that God accomplishes things through the life of Moses, his resume begins to talk about future accomplishments by his past experiences. And so what we are going through today in this COVID-19, understand that God is building your spiritual resume. And God is allowing us to go through this, as I've said before, for our benefit and for his glory and in his honor. There's going to be a time in the coming future, in the years to come, where we're going to stand up and say, man, I remember the year 2020. I remember when America was shut down. I remember when millions of people were in unemployment. I remember when the church wasn't able to meet. But I remember how we were victorious over the obstacles and how those obstacles turned into times of great opportunity. And you're going to need to remember what you're going through here right now, just like Moses had to remember what he went through and had to build a resume of faithfulness through the obstacles of life. So we're building today, in the time period that we're living in, a resume of faith. Well, what is in this resume of faith? First of all, the resume is a focus upon the facts. It's a focus upon the facts. Look at Exodus chapter 13, and we'll look at verses 3 through 8. So when we build our resume, it has to be factual. If we're going to talk about the victory we have in Jesus Christ 3, 4, 5 years down the road, it has to be factual in your life today. You can't build that spiritual resume. You can't add to that spiritual resume if you're failing in your faith today. If you're filled with doubt and fear and discouragement and worry and concerned about every little thing, you'll not be able to build the resume today to show your children and your grandchildren and the heritage in the next decade or the next years. And so Our resume must focus upon facts. It has to be true. In your resume, in the physical resume, every time you put down where you went to school, you put a contact number. With every fact on the resume, you put a person's name and a contact number so that the person looking at that resume can check you out. And so you realize that your resume has to be based upon facts. Remembering the past, but it has to be true, it has to be honest, because that resume is going to be checked out. So let's notice, first of all, as we focus on the facts, we got to remember the past. Remember the past. Exodus chapter 13, beginning in verse number 3. And Moses said unto the people, notice these words, remember this day. That day is the day they're coming out of Egyptian bondage. And Moses is going to make sure, and God's going to make sure, they're never going to forget that day they leave Egypt, because that's what Passover is all about. They were freed from Egyptian bondage on Passover. And then they left and found themselves at the Red Sea on the day of unleavened bread. And God wanted to make sure that they would never forget, and they would always remember that day of leaving Egyptian captivity. So he says in verse 3, remember this day in which you came out from Egypt, out of the house of bondage, for by strength of hand the Lord brought you out from this place. There shall no leavened bread be eaten. This day came ye out in the month of Abib. And it shall be, when the Lord shall bring thee in the land of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Hivites and the Jebusites, which he sware unto thy fathers to give thee, a land flowing with milk and honey, that thou shalt keep this service in this month, unleavened bread. 7 days thou shalt eat unleavened bread, and the seventh day shall be a feast to the Lord. Unleavened bread shall be eaten 7 days, and there shall no leavened bread be seen with thee, neither shall there be leaven seen with thee in all thy quarters. And notice especially verse number 8. And thou shalt show thy son in that day, saying, this is done because of that which the Lord did unto me when I came forth out of Egypt. You see, they had to start building this resume. They had to focus upon the facts. And God said, God told Moses, I want you to remember this day. And this day is going to be the day of Passover, when you prepared to leave. And when you came to the Red Sea, you came on the day of unleavened bread. And they still remember those two feasts today. They still celebrate Passover. They still celebrate unleavened breads. Why? Because they want to focus upon the facts. They must remember the victories of the past. How sad it is that an entire generation is going to pass from the scene because they couldn't remember the victories of the past. All they could see is the failures of the future, and that whole generation died, so that the next generation after 40 years comes up, now they can remember the past when they stood this day at the mouth of the Red Sea and the Egyptians were behind them. God is going to use this time of adversity and focus upon the facts and build their resume so that even today, thousands of years later, they can remember that time when they left Egypt, and they can focus upon the facts. They can focus upon the future, and they don't have to fear the future because they remember the past. And so God wants them to recall the past in order to bring up confidence in the present. You see, there's things I can look back in my family. We can look back and we see that God's never forsaken us. And God has always gotten us out of very difficult and sometimes fearful situations and sometimes life-threatening situations. And I'm not going to forget that. Not that I want to just glory in that. I want to prepare myself for whatever obstacle comes tomorrow. I want to be able to remember all that God has done in the past, because the same God that did that in the past is the same God that's going to get us through today. And so we need to remember what we're going through right this very moment. And focusing upon the facts, you want to show how you came up with solutions. What's the solution that your family came up with to survive this time? What's the solution that others saw when others only see failure? How can you use that to encourage yourself and encourage your family? How are you able to turn around a difficult situation and make a difficult situation profitable? That's the first aspect of our resume of faith. We need to focus on the facts. So as we see in verse 3 again of Exodus 13, remember this day. Remember this day. And he says in this day, in verse number 8, he says, thou shalt show thy son in that day, saying, this is done because of that which the Lord did unto me when I came forth out of Egypt. And so several thousand years ago, there's still Orthodox Jews, a father and their sons, that sat down this year on that Passover and unleavened bread. And they said, son, this is why we do this. Because we're remembering what happened back in the land of Egypt. You know what they do not understand? The way the Jews celebrate, they take the wafer. There's three little wafers. They take one of the wafers, they break it in half. And then they hide it in a handkerchief. And then the kids go looking forward to find it, if I believe the story right, on the third day. They're celebrating the resurrection of Jesus Christ during unleavened bread, and they don't even know it. So the resume of faith, we must focus on the fact. We must remember this day. We must show our sons and explain to them how God brought victory. I won't turn to Exodus 12:14. But this is what it says about unleavened bread. And this day shall be unto you for a memorial, and ye shall keep it a feast to the Lord throughout your generations. Ye shall keep it a feast by ordinance forever. You know, we have an ordinance that's been left us that we remember on the first Sunday of every single month, and that's the Lord's Supper. And we say every time, this do in remembrance of me. So we look back at that crucifixion, which to the disciples looked like a great tragedy at the time. But to us, 2,000 years in the future, we find out it's the greatest blessing that ever happened was on the most tragic day of history when Jesus' body was broken and his blood was shed. But we remember that, and we do it in remembrance of me. So a resume of faith, we must focus on the facts. And then in this resume of faith, we need a record of faith. We need a record of faith. Look at verses 10 through 12 in Exodus chapter 14 once again. Exodus 14, verses 10 through 12. We need a record of faith. And when Pharaoh drew nigh, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them, and they were sore afraid. And the children of Israel cried unto the Lord, and they said unto Moses, because there were no graves in Egypt, hast thou taken us away to die in the wilderness? Wherefore hast thou dealt thus with us to carry us forth out of Egypt? Is not this the word that we did tell thee in Egypt, saying, let us alone, that we may serve the Egyptians? For it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness. I want you to notice there's a record of faith. For many of them, it's a record of a lack of faith. That generation that's going to die before they go into the promised land, this is a record on their resume that's a blot, something they wish they could have blotted out. But on that younger generation, those that are 19 and younger, this is on their record of faith to show how God took them out of Egypt, put the Egyptian army behind them, the Red Sea in front of them, put the pillar of cloud and the fire behind the children of Israel, put a big cloud up so that the Egyptians couldn't even find their way to the Israelite camp. The younger generation is going to record this, and it's going to be a record of faith on their resume. But here's what we notice about this record of faith. Faith, first of all, is preceded by fear. Faith is preceded by fear. Notice verse number 10 in Exodus 14. Faith is preceded by fear. And when Pharaoh drew nigh, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them, and they were sore afraid, and the children of Israel cried out unto the Lord. You see, sight is the exact opposite of faith. Corinthians 5:7 says, "For we walk by faith and not by sight." But faith has to be tested in order to be true. It has to be tried in order to be trusted. So what we're going to see as they build this resume of faith, that faith is preceded by fear. Verse number 10, it says, they lifted up their eyes. They lifted up their eyes. That is the destroyer of faith. When you make decisions based upon what you see rather than who you know, it's always going to lead you into a deeper fear. It's always going to make the situation worse and keep you in that despondency even longer when you go by what your eyes see. So their faith is preceded by fear. And then notice verse number 11. It's then when they go by what they see, then they're going to go by what they believe. Because what you see has a direct effect upon what you believe. And so verse number 11, they say, Moses, you brought us out here to die. We're going to die in the wilderness. And they're saying, our fears have been realized. We told you that this is exactly what was going to happen. And because they looked out and they saw with their eyes determined what they would believe. And then what they believed was shown in verse number 10, is that certain slavery is better than uncertain freedom. That's because they used their eyes. What they see caused them to believe what was false. Then what they believe caused them to come up with a wrong statement, a wrong belief. Certain slavery is better than uncertain freedom. Our whole American history is exact opposite. Uncertain freedom is much better than certain slavery. And we have a history of that in our nation. A very independent group of people. Americans have their Constitution, their Bill of Rights. They fought, they bled, and they died in order to establish the nation that we have today. And so faith is preceded by fear. And then let's notice, go on, and we're building this resume. Look at verse 12. Fear predicts the future. Fear will predict the future. Verse number 12, Exodus 14. Is not this the word that we did tell thee in Egypt, saying, let us alone that we may serve the Egyptians? For it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness. So you see how fear predicts the future? They say, it's better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the wilderness. That's not a true statement. They have no idea what it would be like to go back to Egypt and become servants again. They could have all died if they returned and went back. The Egyptians could have murdered them, could have killed them. But fear causes you to predict a future based upon what you see, based upon what you believe, and then predicting a future. And that future is, we should have just went back to Egypt. It's better to serve the Egyptians than to die in the wilderness. See, fear predicts the future. Faith doesn't predict the future. Faith lives in the present and lets God take care of the future. But if you live in fear, fear will always predict the future. If you're living in fear as parents, your children are going to be living in fear. If you're sitting around living in doubt and worry and you're concerned and you're expressing your doubts and fears like these Israelites did in front of the Red Sea, it impacted that whole generation because fear predicts the future, and fear always works against us. Fear always works against us. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 17 and 18. So fear will cause you to predict a future, but it's a very uncertain future because nobody knows what is going to happen in the future. And so in the day and the age that we live in, if we live in fear, we're going to say something like this: I know we're just going to lose our house. They're going to come repossess our car. We're going to lose our health. We're going to lose all of our finances. We're going to lose all of our food. The meats are gone in all of the stores. We can't find any tissue paper. Woe is me. Here's what your children are going to do. They're going to predict their future by what the future you just predicted for them. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Notice what Paul says, 2 Corinthians 4, verse 17. For our light affliction. We know anything about Paul's life, it wasn't light, but that's how he interpreted it. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us. It doesn't work against you. It works for us. Why? Because you're building a resume of faith. It's but for a moment. It worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen. See, that's a problem with the Israelites. We're not to look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Very quickly, Paul brings out just six thoughts about living by faith. First of all, he says, affliction is light. Why is it light? Because he lives by faith and knows the eternal weight of glory. Secondly, he says, my affliction's but for a moment. It's just one lifetime, and then it's forever. Thirdly, he says, affliction works for me, not against me. Why? Because he has a resume of faith and not a resume of fear. He says, fourthly, it's an eternal weight of glory versus a light affliction of grief for the moment. Fifthly, he says, I'm not looking at what is seen. Isn't that amazing? People that live by faith will not live by fear, because what they see, they will not believe. What they perceive from the Word of God, that's what we believe. So look not at what is seen. Then lastly, he compares the temporal to the eternal. So be careful as you build this resume, because fear predicts the future. Faith allows God to provide the grace for the future. And then nextly, back in verses 13 and 14 of Exodus chapter 14, the future is determined by facts. The future is determined by facts. Fear must be followed up with truth. Fear must be followed up with truth. So the future is determined by facts. Verse 13 and 14, Exodus 14. And Moses said unto the people, fear ye not, stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show to you today. For the Egyptians whom you have seen today, ye shall see them again no more forever. The Lord shall fight for you, and ye shall hold your peace. You see, fear must be followed up with truth. Now, it wasn't just a few weeks before this, or months, we're not sure, that Moses was saying, Lord, not me, I can't do that job. There's no way, I'm scared to death of those people there in Egypt. Those Israelites, they're not going to listen to me. And let me give you all the excuses. And you can tell God by me arguing with you, I'm slow of tongue. But now, isn't amazing that this same Moses is now telling the people, listen, don't be afraid. Stand still. See the salvation of the Lord. You're never going to see these Egyptians again. Well, Moses, how do you know that? Well, let me show you my resume where my fear turned to faith, where I tried to predict the future because of fear and I was wrong. He uses his resume that God has built to encourage other people in their time of fear. So the future is determined by the facts. So if you notice the response of Moses, he had been through the same process to build his resume of faith over fear. Faith over fear. It's a good thing to be in a position of fear if your next step is a position of faith, and not by sight, but by faith. Because you need to understand that your God, my God, is greater than anything that the world can throw against us. There's absolutely no reason to fear. Will people die in the virus? Yes, tens of thousands have. But as a child of God, that's just waking up in heaven. I can't see that as any lose anywhere in that equation. So Moses had to build up his resume of faith over fear. You know, every Christian that God used had to go through that same thing. All the apostles said, Lord, you can count on us. We'll be right here with you. When those Roman soldiers come, we're not going to forsake you. We're not going to run. We're not afraid. We'll take them all on. And they had two swords against Roman armies, and they were going to fight. Except when they saw the fight, fear came up. When fear comes up, it predicts a very uncertain future. When fear came up, they fled. Why? Because the future is, they're going to kill us too. Well, not tonight, but eventually, yeah, they're going to. But every apostle ran in fear that they might return in faith. Peter, even after he saw the Lord resurrected from the dead, he said to several of his friends, apostles that were fishermen, he says, I go fishing. The rest of them said, several of them said, we're going with you. We're just going back to what we know because this living by faith is uncertain, and I don't like not knowing what's going to happen. And yet he was crucified upside down on a cross, tradition tells us. There was doubting Thomas. I'll not believe until I can put my hands and fingers into the print of the nails. Everyone that does something great for God has to face down fear and resolve not to predict the future and realize allow the future to be determined by the facts of God's word. And so Moses says in verses 13 and 14, he says, fear not. Why could Moses say fear not? Because he'd been in a place of fear. He predicted a false future, and God has used him to bring the children of Israel out of Egyptian bondage. He said, what are you afraid of? Didn't you see the 10 plagues? What are you afraid of? Then he says, stand still. If you're so busy running away in fear, you're never going to stand still and silent to see what God is doing. Stand still, look around, see what he's doing for you. Then Moses says, thirdly, listen, you need to see God's salvation. This is the last time you ever seen these folks. As you're crossing the Red Sea, just kind of turn around and just go, we're not seeing you ever again. See God's salvation, Moses tells the people. He says, the Lord shall fight for you. He says, fifthly, hold your peace. Don't lose hope. The future is determined by facts. And then lastly, notice verse number 15 in Exodus chapter 14, verse number 15. And the Lord said unto Moses, wherefore criest thou unto me? In other words, are you backsliding, Moses? What are you doing crying? You got the power of God right there in your hand and that silly stick. So verse 15, the Lord said to Moses, wherefore criest thou unto me? Speak unto the children of Israel that they go forward. You see, follow through with the facts. God never tells us to retreat and go backwards. He says, Moses, just speak the truth to the people. Don't cry unto me about it. Sounds like a good idea. If I was him, I think I'd be crying. He says, simply speak to the children of Israel. Don't react in panic. Don't throw up your hands in despair. Just say, guys, get up and start walking forward. Moses, there's a Red Sea there. Won't be in just a moment. Follow through with the facts. Go forward. Use what God has already given you. For Moses, it was the staff that represented the power of God. He lifts his staff over the Red Sea, believing that God's going to part the sea, something he's never seen before, nothing he's ever heard before, and yet he obeys, and the Red Sea rolls back, and they go over on dry ground. Follow through with the facts. We'll go ahead and stop there tonight. That's an amazing story at the Red Sea. You know, look at it, be encouraged by it, realize the uncertainty of the times that we live in. It's here for our benefit. It's here to build a life testimony that we can leave behind for our children. Let's build today that resume of faith and that we can leave for the next generation. Let's pray. Father, we bow before your presence to give thanks for the opportunity we've had to study your word. And Lord, that we each and every one of us are building a resume, and Lord, it's either going to be a resume of faith or it's going to be a resume of fear. And Lord, we're going to leave that resume to those that come after us. Lord, may we refuse to walk by sight. May we walk by faith. May we, as the children of Israel, were commanded by Moses, go forward. Go forward. Lord, I can't imagine what that sounded like to 2.5 million Jews that are at the mouth of the Red Sea. How can they go forward? But as soon as their foot touched the water, Lord, you rolled back the sea, and they walked through on dry ground. What a resume, what a fact that they could put into the resume to encourage those of future generations. Lord, would you help us to be courageous, to be brave, to be straightforward, to not live in fear, but to live in faith. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, Lord bless you, and we'll see you on Sunday. Hope it's going to be a great Mother's Day for all of you. And so we're looking to have a very special service again on this Mother's Day. God bless you.